Your top holding is Nvidia and all paths lead back, but Microsoft's a big one, Broadcom, Alphabet, really all of the big winners. Is this playing out as you anticipated?
Yeah, well, I think that AI is a huge productivity driver, in my opinion. And I think that these companies are really well positioned to essentially capture that and be the platforms for, I think, growth in the economy. And, what I'm looking for going forward is the new use cases really come through, like agentic AI, for example. I think it's to fill this capacity, it can't just be you and me using ChatGPT. It's got to be, thousands of agents for each company, like making decisions and executing and unlocking, I think, labor essentially is what I'm looking for. And that's what's exciting going forward.
It's exciting when you see Nvidia's name referenced in about three of the compute deals just on this Monday alone. But take us to perhaps the one that you don't own. Interestingly, you don't have exposure to Amazon and AWS, but it signs its deal with OpenAI. Has there been methodology around that about its own cloud prowess or perhaps worries about the lack of growth that we'd seen in previous quarters, bar from the previous numbers they just reported Friday?
Hey, well, I think that they had a nice earnings report, and I do think that there seems to be a lot more momentum now. You talk about the deal that they just did today, and just essentially like rolling out a lot more compute and accelerating AWS, I think is really good for the business. I think they're well positioned to essentially leverage AI in their e-commerce business as well as be an infrastructure provider. So I don't think you can count them out at all. And it's good to see them, outperforming.
What's interesting is someone who got beaten up is in the portfolio, which is Meta. And I'm interested in your take of how we're deciding who we reward of capital expenditure and who we don't.
Yeah, well, I think that, AI is a long-term investment for Meta. And I think that the market's probably digesting the, high level of CapEx and the depreciation that's coming through the P&L. But I think that's a little bit too short-term to view it. And you look past that, the returns are there, and these are going to be great investments. Meta definitely has the digital formats to leverage AI and the tremendous scale across customers. And so I think it's exciting what they're doing in the SMB segment as well. If it unlocks a lot of ability for companies to essentially like reach customers with just a credit card and asking for the ROI from ad campaigns.
I just want to go to what President of Microsoft was telling our network a little bit earlier today about the risks of underinvesting really here. We spoke with Brad Smith. Just take a listen, Tony.
Our biggest challenge is not a risk of getting ahead of demand. It's actually keeping pace with demand. And what we are finding is that our customers, whether they be enterprises across the economy or governments or nonprofits, they are looking to us to build out this capacity. They want to use this compute. So for us, if we build it, it will be put to use. As it's put to use, there will be a return to our shareholders.
You, of course, have exposure to Microsoft, Tony. Brad really talking about how they're expanding more geographically as well and investing over in the Middle East, not just taking money from the Middle East. And I'm interested in what you think about Microsoft's need to depend on neoclouds. We saw them strike a deal with an Australian neocloud provider for Texas data centers. Is that something you like to see, that use of their money and capital expenditure on neocloud as well as their own?
Yeah, I think it allows them to be flexible and nimble. I think that standing up these data centers is no small feat. And a lot of times it requires various players, it requires the data center capacity, the power. And so I think it's encouraging to see Microsoft collaborate with the ecosystem and plug in partners. And so to me, I think it makes sense. I think it's also a testament to the demand signals they're seeing. And kind of the workloads really take off. And, I think AI is really hard to do. Not every company that is trying to do it is successful, but I think the ones that are finding success are, seeing tremendous promise. And so I think that's what essentially, gives people confidence to invest here.
Confidence to keep adding when we've seen runaway performance, not just of Nvidia at $5 trillion, but another one of your holdings, Micron, for example. I mean, significant outperformance. When do you decide that you want to cash in, profit take?
Yeah, we're all constantly managing position sizes in the portfolio. But, in my opinion, I think that you want to be invested in the areas where there is essentially a bottleneck, that there's scarcity, and that performance depends on it. So I think that HBM, memory, HDDs, and now NAND, there's becoming more of a shortage. And so to me, the industry is getting better, and it's a critical component. From my perspective, there is opportunity for these companies to compound value over time.
You are, of course, equity focused, but when we have Alphabet selling debt in Europe and the US, any of that financing of this AI spend give you pause?
Yeah, well, I think it's novel, but you look at the cash generation of a lot of these companies, they're really blue chip. And to me, I think that this investment is smart, and to do some the appropriate level of debt financing, I think, can make sense. In addition, I think that the infrastructure, there's a lot of debate of like the useful life of this. I know that NVIDIA comes out with a new generation every year, but I think that these are longer lived assets than people appreciate potentially, and they're not just like 3 years obsolescence, but probably more like 5 to 6. And so, in terms of the appetite to lend against it, I think that in 3 or 4 years, it's going to be more commonly accepted. I think we're probably on the path there. Because these are really, like, I think, revenue generating assets, and there's a lot of productivity coming off of them.
And Tony, that productivity, as you started the conversation, is about how we deploy generative AI, and Palantir's one that really has. But how do they fight also the macro headwinds, the government shutdown? Do you have any concerns at the valuations that some of these companies trade at?
Hey, absolutely. I mean, these are, very elevated multiples, and so they need to keep delivering the growth here. Palantir is definitely, I think, at the tip of the spear in terms of implementing AI. I mean, they started doing that in the government, and now their commercial business is growing rapidly. And so, I think the government shut down, I think that's probably a temporary thing. They could get a pass for that just because the government's not going to be shut down forever. And you look forward, I think what really matters is that they're driving significant ROI for their customers, and they're able to do it in a way that connects their data. And I think that's like the change in IT services is I think that you need to come with a solution and the engineers to help your customers instead of implementing like a SaaS-based off-the-shelf solution. So I think that's what's exciting. And we'll see later on today.